Hello, my name is Stephen Griffin. I am a senior escalation engineer in developer support messaging here in commercial tech support at Microsoft. In this presentation, I will be discussing various tips and tricks for developing apps for the Office Store. Earlier versions of Office could be extended through various mechanisms, including COM add-ins, VSDO, macros, and Exchange client extensions in Outlook. Many of these mechanisms are still present in Office 2013. We've added a new mechanism, Apps for Office. Apps for Office are a new HTML JavaScript-based way of extending Office applications. An app consists of two parts, a manifest, which is an XML-based file that describes the capabilities of the app and where it is located, and the web page, which implements the functionality of the app. This allows us to develop apps which can integrate into traditional desktop Office clients as well as into Office web apps. The same code can run in both clients, easing both development and deployment. NAPA. The best way to get started with apps for Office is to use NAPA. Let's go look at the website where you can get that. So if you come here, you can follow the instructions to sign up for a trial for Office 365 for developers. This will get you access to the Office Professional Plus 2013 preview and Exchange Online 2013 preview environments, as well as the NAPA Office 365 development tools, which will allow you to start developing apps for Office immediately after your servers are provisioned. Let's discuss manifests. Your manifest is not your app. The functionality of your app is a website you host on a web server or a SharePoint site. Your manifest is an XML file that contains metadata about your app, including links to the server on which the website is hosted. In the case of mail apps, the manifest is then published to an Exchange server. When you use NAPA to build a mail app, your website and your manifest will both be published to the same Office 365 environment, contributing to the confusion. However, for the remainder of this presentation, I will tend to use app to mean either the website or the manifest and website in combination. When you develop and publish an app using NAPA, it will be hosted on a SharePoint server in your trial Office 365 environment. This is great for development and testing, but this is not a substitute for your production environment. For production, you'll want to deploy your app to a non-trial environment. For instance, I have an app deployed to a web instance hosted on Azure. Currently, the manifest NAPA will publish during your testing only supports desktop apps. It will not include entries for tablet or phone apps, meaning, for instance, that your app will be inaccessible from OWA running on an iPad. There are two ways to deal with this. One way is to open your project in Visual Studio and modify the manifest there, or build a manifest by hand to use for testing. This hand-built manifest can include sections for tablet and phone apps and can point to your SharePoint-hosted app. NAPA Office 365 credentials can fail when testing in a corporate environment. The symptom of this is a NAPA app which works when run on a non-domain machine but fails to load when you're running on a domain machine. One workaround to this is to add https://*.sharepoint.com to your trusted sites in Internet Explorer. I've included a link to a forum posting discussing this issue in the notes to this presentation. The URL NAPA will publish your app to in SharePoint will change periodically. If you don't reload OWA, you might still be using the old non-functional URL. For instance, when I publish my app, the manifest registered with Exchange contains a URL where the domain name is contoso.sharepoint.com. However, this redirects to a URL where contoso is followed by a string of hex characters. This longer URL is where the app was really published. Your browser will remember this redirect as you navigate around OWA. If you republish your app and the location changes, OWA and the browser may not be able to find your app anymore because they will be looking in the wrong place. However, reloading the page will send you through the redirect again, allowing it to load. You will see similar behavior with the desktop apps, Outlook, Word, Excel, and so on. Closing and reloading these applications will load the app from the current location. The following slides will discuss other lessons I have learned in my time working with Office apps. Topics I will be covering include Visual Studio, browser differences, permissions, app limitations, and Exchange Web Services, or EWS. Some tips for app development using Visual Studio. First, migrating an app's development environment from Napa to Visual Studio is easy. From the Napa site, simply select to open in Visual Studio. Your code will be converted into a Visual Studio project. However, there is no mechanism for starting with an app project in Visual Studio and opening it in Napa. This can make it difficult to keep a Napa project and a Visual Studio project in sync. Once you've moved your project from Napa to Visual Studio, you'll either need to keep it there or manually keep the files in sync. Second, when you run or debug your app from Visual Studio, it will publish a manifest which points to a local website. This local website can take some time to get running, leading to app load failures when the framework times out waiting for your app to respond. Your first attempt to view an app after starting it under the debugger will nearly always fail, as Visual Studio can take some time to load symbols. Once you see the Visual Studio loading symbols, I recommend you wait until it indicates it is done before attempting to view the app again. Finally, Visual Studio's use of a local website is great for debugging a desktop app, as you can have browsers installed on your development machine and they will have no problem accessing the website. However, accessing this site from another machine or from a phone or a tablet can be difficult, if not impossible. So, when testing phone or tablet scenarios, you may find it useful to deploy the app to a test environment that you haven't advertised in the Office Store. You can then test your phone and tablet scenarios safely. Browser differences. Longtime Office developers are likely more accustomed to technologies such as C++, Visual Basic, VSTO, and .NET. As such, they may not be as familiar with HTML5 and JavaScript, the basis for apps for Office. Since an app for Office is essentially a website, it needs to function correctly in all of the major browsers. In the notes to this presentation, I give a link to the validation policies for the Office Store, which detail exactly which browsers must be supported for which apps. For instance, here's a quote from version 1.3 of the validation policy. Apps for Office running on Outlook Web App 2013 must be fully functional with Internet Explorer 9 and 10 and the latest versions of Chrome and Firefox. In addition, I would also recommend testing mail apps with Safari. Finally, you can minimize browser differences by making extensive use of the jQuery JavaScript library. Permissions. There are three levels of permissions a mail app can request, depending on the operations it needs to perform. They are restricted, read item, and read write mailbox. The various capabilities granted in these three permission levels are spelled out in the documentation for apps for Office. Pay close attention to the app permissions you request. Attempts to use permissions you don't have will lead to errors which may not be immediately obvious. This can crop up especially if you use Exchange Web Services, or EWS, to get information not normally available via the JavaScript API. EWS calls require the read-write mailbox permission, even if you never make a call to write data. Only administrators can install apps which request read-write mailbox. This means that apps which use EWS can only be installed by administrators, even if the apps never use EWS to write data. Limitations. Several limitations for apps for Office are listed in the documentation. For instance, mail apps are limited to at most 15 activation rules, and you can have at most 3 outstanding asynchronous calls at one time. Take some time to study these limitations and how they might apply to your app. Those of you who have been developing against Exchange Web Services using the EWS Managed API may be disappointed to learn that you will need to do the bulk of your EWS work by hand. The Make EWS Request Async function does simplify things somewhat. All you need to do is build your request XML, call Make EWS Request Async with your XML and a callback function, and your callback function will be called with the result. Since you don't need to worry about auto-discover, this means making the calls is fairly simple. Parsing the EWS responses can be tricky until you figure out how to navigate the results. EWS results are in XML format. You can load XML into a DOM using jQuery's parse XML function, at which point you would expect to use a selector to grab the node containing the information you need. However, EWS nodes will have names like T:internet message headers. Different browsers will handle selecting these nodes differently. You could use browser detection to determine which selector to use, or just try different selectors until one works. Or you can do something a bit more elegant. The jQuery extension given here will walk the DOM until it finds the desired node. This will make it easy to grab your results from the parsed XML DOM. In my testing, this code works in all major browsers. The following slides discuss debugging. Several major browsers provide mechanisms for debugging website development. In Internet Explorer, the F12 developer tools will get you to a built-in debugger, which I have found to be quite powerful. In addition to traditional debugging staples, such as breakpoints and variable examination, the F12 debugger has several features which have proven helpful in debugging apps for Office. For instance, the Network Trace tab in the F12 debugger will show you when OWA is trying to load an app from an out-of-date URL, or when your app isn't loading due to authentication issues. The HTML tab allows you to edit your HTML and CSS on the fly, saving several cycles of republishing your app as you work out your code. The same is true of the console and script tabs, which are both functional even when you're not actively debugging your code, as you can always type in expressions to see how they evaluate. When testing phone and tablet scenarios, you may find that portions of your app don't function as expected, but you have fewer options for direct debugging. For this reason, it will pay off to invest time early on in building a logging mechanism into your app. One simple logging mechanism is a status area in your app's user interface where you can easily write messages as you move through various portions of your code flow. In this way, you can quickly determine which pieces of your code are getting touched and which are not, highlighting where your logic may need some work. Let's take a look at some demos. In the following demos, we will create a mail app using NAPA, take a look at a more complicated mail app, the Message Header Analyzer, and use the F12 debugger to look at the SharePoint authentication issues. Let's see how easy it is to create an app using NAPA. This is the NAPA interface here. I'm going to click on Add New Project. Mail app for Office. My test mail app. And create. At this point, I have a fully functional mail app ready to deploy. We've got the HTML here, the script, and some CSS already filled out for us. Additionally, we have properties available for our app, where we can set the permissions that we require. Right now we have read item, which is all we need, and the activation rules. We're going to leave all these as the default. Let's deploy this app. At this point, the app is deployed, and let's take a look at it. This is OWA in my Office 365 environment. Here I have an email, and here is the app ready to activate on the email. Let's activate it. And we see that it was able to run and pull the subject and the to and the from. Let's take a look at a slightly more complicated app. This app uses Exchange Web Services, so I need to install it through the Exchange Administrator. Organization, apps. And here we go to the Office Store where I've published the app. Okay, the app is now installed, but if we look, it's disabled. Let's edit that and make it mandatory. Now, if we go back to Outlook, we should see that app is available to activate. And there it is. Let's take a look at the SharePoint authentication problem I discussed earlier. Here I'm activating an app, and we're going to see that it fails to load. Now, let's use the F12 debugger to watch what happened. I'm going to start capturing here, close the app, and reload it. Now, at this point, we see we have a logon frame, and if we look at the response body, we see that we're failing to authenticate. So let's stop capturing that and take a look at the fix. We can go to Trusted Sites, add star.sharepoint.com, I've closed the browser and reopened it. Now let's see what happens when we activate the app. Good, and we can watch that under the network capture. And here we see that our app was loaded. Here's your partner services contact information. Thank you for listening to this presentation.